Well, that's coming. So Danny's going to be reading from the People's Advocate tonight. I met Danny in that aisle right over there about 3.5 years ago after watching a presentation he'd done on YouTube about the Kennedy assassination as an example of the structure of a conspiracy. And it set me off on a path of doing research that I hadn't done since I was in college and that I've always been curious about since I was 7 when the Kennedy assassination happened. So I've ended up the last couple of semesters helping Danny out with the JFK class, and I've done quite a bit of reading and quite a bit of studying with him basically as my guide, with having so much inside information, taking depositions and so on. Case after case he's done this with, but that one in particular I think catches everybody's interest probably that's in this room. And what this is about, the book, the classes, everything that he's doing right now is increasing the base, so to speak, of people that still believe in the Constitution and still believe that, you know, behind that is more than just a bunch of words and might makes right. There's something divinely inspired about it, regardless of your organized religion beliefs and so on. And I didn't really even understand how clear-cut that argument is between what's going on there right now on both sides until I read it in that book. And if you haven't read it yet, it reads like a dream. It reads like a Robert Ludlum novel, but it's his life. So I won't bore you with too much more of this. We'll just bring Danny on. Danny, let's go.
You know, Sarah and I lived in Washington, D.C. for 20 years, working on various cases as the Christic Institute. But we kept coming back to Santa Cruz repeatedly during various cases. The Karen Silkwood case, when we were working on trying to stop the construction of all private nuclear power plants in the United States, that we ultimately succeeded in doing in that particular case. And then when we were doing the Iran-Contra case, we came back a number of times and spoke on the campus and spoke in different places back when before the earthquake here in town. So we spent a fair amount of time here, so we've gotten to know some of the people in Santa Cruz. And we ended up, after the Iran-Contra case, and I'll touch on a few of these as we're going along here this evening, but we were asked to, Sarah was asked to, where is Sarah? Sarah is up there. There she is. Working as usual. Sarah was asked to become the executive director of the State of the World Forum with Jimmy Garrison, who was a longtime dear friend of ours from when Jimmy and I were in divinity school together, back at Harvard Divinity School. And we came out to California, and we actually spent time teaching at the University of California, Santa Barbara. And I'll touch on some of these things. They're all set forth in the book. It's funny because, you know, virtually everybody that we know, they know us from one case or another. The Karen Silkwood case, the American Sanctuary Movement case, the Greensboro Civil Rights case down in North Carolina, or the Iran-Contra case. But everybody kept saying, look, we know that from this particular case, but we just found out, for example, that you were legal counsel during the Wounded Knee occupation out in South Dakota. And how come we never knew about that? You know, you were at the prison the night everybody was killed. Oh, gee, you ought to write a book. So people kept saying that to us. But we just kept doing one case after another case, and we never got time to write a book. And then it became clear that you never get time to write a book.
But this is the opening book. This is the 101. This is the introductory course that tells about that period of history. And as I say in the opening, and there's this, I guess it's this obligatory thing that one's supposed to read out of the book. As most of you know, I wrote it, so I don't really need to read it because I know what I said. But they've asked me to do this. So that the what it says. So I dedicated the book. Everybody kept saying, you know, well, who are you going to dedicate the book to? And what I did is I ended up saying to the courageous people whom I've had the privilege of representing as an attorney over my 45 years of legal practice, from Bill Baird, who had the courage to be the first to stand up for the right of every unmarried person to engage in responsible birth control, to Paul Pappas, who first stood up for the right of every journalist to protect the identity of her or his confidential news sources, to Daniel Ellsberg and the editors of the New York Times, who had the courage to release the Pentagon Papers to the world, to Karen Silkwood, who died to stop the construction of dangerous new private nuclear power plants in our country, and to stop the smuggling of bomb-grade plutonium to Israel and to Iran by our American CIA, to the members of the American Indian Movement, who stood their ground against the power of the U.S. government at Wounded Knee, to the journalists who died in the jungles of Central America at the hands of the off-the-shelf enterprise of Ronald Reagan and George H.W. Bush, to Tony Avergon, who survived that attack to give rise to the Iran-Contra scandal, to Archbishop John Fitzpatrick and Stacey Lynn Merck and their co-workers at Casa Romero on the Texas border, who struggled in the American sanctuary movement to give refuge to the innocents who had fled the death squads in Latin America, trained and funded by our American government, to the courageous friends of Mayor Eddie Carthan, the first elected black mayor in the Deep Delta of Mississippi, and to the young men and women who gave their lives on the streets of Greensboro, North Carolina, confronting the Ku Klux Klan, who together successfully pushed back the night of American racism, to all of the other lesser well-known women and men whom I have had the privilege of representing, who had the courage to give real meaning to our American Constitution, this work is dedicated. Without those courageous people, there would be no people's advocate. So, these are some of the people who I've had the privilege to represent down through the years. And it turns out that people always say, wait a second, I recognize that case. The cases that you got to do are ones that somehow became famous. And so they say, how in the world did you happen to end up in all of those famous cases? Well, the answer is they're not famous when we first start with them. They sort of become so as we go along through it. There's a cast of characters that are in the book, and as I say, the book is not so much about me. It's about the cases that we did together, the issues that we did together. But frankly, all of those cases, as a pattern, tell of a time, of an era, of the '60s. And as all of us know who lived through the '60s, the '60s didn't take place just between 1961 and 69. You know, they basically began in the mid 50s with the rise of Elvis Presley and the rock and roll music and James Dean and Rebel Without a Cause and Marlon Brando and, you know, On the Waterfront and all of these people that were from our generation that began to give our generation a kind of a distinctive quality and cohesion. And it actually went on through that big famous year of 1968, all the way into 1976, 1977, when the big hearings were held into the Central Intelligence Agency, the Church Committee, the Frank Church of Idaho chaired the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence Abuse, and we all thought that, because we've been taught this, that if we could just publicly reveal the wrongdoing, that somehow the institutions of our government would all line up and solve it. The news media would rush right in and report it, and all of the media would insist that our institutions function. And this is the story of how that ain't so. This is the story that shows one time after another that we believed that. We believed that this was true, and we would bring the information to the Congress, and for some reason they wouldn't do anything about it. And then we'd bring it to the New York Times, and then they wouldn't do anything about it. And then we'd take it to the courts, and the courts we would find were fighting back against us, that they weren't really there to try to have a fair adjudication of the facts. And so this tells the story about how, despite that type of resistance from the institutions, because our generation believed so firmly that what we had been told was true about our institutions, about the promise that our institutions held, because we insisted upon believing it and continuing to force the issue upon them, that we would end up getting part of what it is that we were seeking. And this is the story of those partial victories, also shedding light on the parts of the cases that didn't get satisfied. For example, in the Karen Silkwood case, we were able to win the $10.5 million judgment for her children, the largest judgment, the largest civil judgment in the entire history of the United States up until that particular point in time. And we did win the ruling that declared unconstitutional the financial cap that had been placed on all recoveries against private nuclear facilities by the United States Congress in order to try to stimulate the private development of nuclear power. And we got that declared unconstitutional on the grounds that it was depriving citizens of their Sixth Amendment right to a trial by jury. And because of that, we were able to establish that you could recover as much money from a nuclear power plant as the damages they caused. And because of that, since the day of that ruling, not one single new private nuclear power plant has been ordered or built in the United States. But even though we found out who had killed Karen Silkwood, we found out why they had killed her, we found out exactly the details of how they went about killing her and why, the fact of the matter is all of the congressional offices shut it down. All the law enforcement people wouldn't allow that to be done. The court itself would not allow the evidence to be put in. So that the, even though we know who killed her and why they did it, they allowed those men to go free. So that was a great source of frustration. And the same thing is true, of course, of the Iran-Contra case. Is that we named all the people, we caught all of them, we had the tail numbers off the airplanes they were using to fly the illegal weapons down to the Contras in Central America, and we brought it. For example, I went in with Gene Wheaton, the guy that I'll introduce you to here in the book, went in to meet with an old friend of his who was the head of the DEA, the Drug Enforcement Agency, the Special Task Force. And I sat down with him, with Gene, and I pushed a memo across the table to him that had the names and address of the place where the cocaine was being distributed out of. It was being brought in from the Medellin cocaine cartel into the United States. I had the address of the place, the private unlisted phone number of the building, the code words that you use to call to get into the building, and pushed it across to him, and he looked at it and read it and pushed it back to me and said, "Look, Dan, you know what this is, and so do I. I plan to live to see my retirement." Mm-hmm. Is what he said to me. Mm-hmm. Okay? And so the stories abound in here. And you can open it almost any place and find some kind of startling revelation that tells you that things are not exactly as we had been told they were. When we were in high school and college in our civics courses. But it goes beyond allowing the reader to simply remain disillusioned about our institutions, because it's absolutely essential that one become disillusioned or else you'll continue to be illusioned. And as long as you're illusioned, we'll never be able to solve these problems. So that's the point of this book. The point of this book is to disillusion the people from our generation and the next generation about what our government is really up to, but to provide some sense of hope that we can continue to work together to bring some of these people to justice, to bring partial justice at least to these cases. And so there's a certain cast of characters that I want to introduce you to by one or more of these obligatory readings that I have to do here. As you know, I tend to kind of tell stories rather spontaneously at the drop of a hat. But they want me to read these. So I'll tell you, this is how I met Bill Taylor. Bill Taylor is one of the persons who's been a major investigator for us. And he was at F. Lee Bailey's office. I became one of the three trial lawyers in F. Lee Bailey's office in 1972. 1972 is the year, you'll remember, of the Watergate burglary, June 17th of 1972. F. Lee Bailey, the most criminal defense attorney of the time, was retained to represent James McCord, who was the former CIA wiretapping specialist who was caught in the Watergate Hotel with the three Cubans. And F. Lee Bailey was retained to represent James McCord, and I was one of the three trial lawyers in the office. And Bill Taylor gets assigned to me in the following way, to be my investigator. The next thing on Lee Bailey's agenda, as it turned out, was to get me a haircut. Three months out of the Cahill Gordon Law Firm, I had a pretty well-developed Irish afro head of hair, though not quite so tightly curled as those of some of my African sisters and brothers. This was too much for Lee Bailey, a former squared-away Marine, to bear. So on the Saturday morning of my first weekend at the Catalina Lodge, which is where I had to live down there to help defend Lee Bailey, who'd been indicted for mail fraud. So on the Saturday morning of my first weekend at the Catalina Lodge, I heard a knock on my door. When I opened it, a huge man was standing there. He was my age, but weighed some 225 pounds, with shoulders bulging under an expensive and obviously specially tailored light-colored sports jacket. He was wearing sharply pressed dark blue slacks, the pleats of which on which you could have cut yourself, and a pair of Marine Corps spit-polished black half boots in which I could see my own reflection out of the bottom of my range of vision. On the left lapel of his sports jacket was the distinctive Marine Corps pin. On his right lapel, the equally distinctive battle ribbon pin of a Marine Corps Vietnam veteran. I could see my stunned reflection in the mirrored sunglasses that he wore. Fixing me with a stare from behind those mirrored lenses, he extended his huge right hand to me. I carefully extended my own right hand, which he immediately seized and crushed in a vice-like handshake. Glaring directly into my eyes from his mirrored world, he said, "Taylor, Bill Taylor, I've been assigned by Mr. Bailey to be your personal investigator." Withdrawing my throbbing right hand from his, I managed to say, "Well, that's terrific," and I invited him in. He moved into the living room of my condominium with the wariness of a cat, surveying the surroundings like a well-trained security officer, which, as it turned out, he was. He removed his mirror sunglasses and began, a little self-consciously, to look around for a chair. I didn't have any furniture in the place yet. All I had were two borrowed tomato red beanbag chairs from the sisters across the hall. So I gestured to one of them and invited him to sit down to take a load off. He stared at me. "Marines don't sit in beanbag chairs," he said. I tried to keep myself from laughing in the interest of getting our relationship off to a good start and said, "Okay, suit yourself." I threw myself down into the other beanbag chair, letting the air gush out of it as I sat down. From that vantage, 4 feet below him, I looked up at him and said, "I see there that you were in the crotch," which is military lingo for having served in the Marine Corps in Vietnam. He sort of jerked to attention at my remark, apparently unaware that I had spent time in the military. Yeah, a few years," he said rather awkwardly. "And I see you did a couple of tours there in Nam." "Three tours," he said. "Three tours," I said, struggling to get out of the beanbag chair. I finally regained my footing and exclaimed, "Holy shit, stand right there, I'll be right back." With this, I left Bill Taylor standing in the middle of the living room in my condo, and I dashed across the hall to the jockey sisters, touching them up for a couple of joints, and then quickly dashed back into my condo. Taylor was still standing there, trying to pretend he wasn't totally confused by what was going on. I returned, holding up a joint, and said, "Let's burn one for the core, for the nom. I lit the joint with a bright red Bic lighter I also had borrowed from the jockey sisters. A look of horror suddenly filled his features. He backed away from the poorly rolled joint, saying, I don't do drugs." And I said, "Who the fuck do you think that you're bullshitting, Marine? You did three tours in the NOM, and you're standing there trying to tell me that you don't smoke dope? What the fuck kind of a fool do you think I am?" I took a big, long drag, and holding my breath, held out the joint toward him. After a full 6 seconds of conflicted resistance, Bill Taylor exploded in a huge laugh. With the experienced touch that has become a virtual handshake between most members of our generation, he expertly plucked the joint out of my outstretched fingers and dragged down a hit that would have felled a full-grown water buffalo. He held it until I relaxed, until I released a smoke-filled billow of laughter that caused him to expel his own lung full of smoke into the air. We both fell on the floor laughing. So that's how I met Bill Taylor, the three tour Vietnam Marine Corps combat. So that was Bill Taylor, the squared away Marine, who has been our chief investigator now for almost 40 years. And Bill, during the three tours in Vietnam that he spent, had gotten to meet a lot of young men then who were in Marine Corps Criminal Investigation Division, U.S. Army Criminal Investigation Division, OSI, the Office of Special Investigation for the Air Force, the Naval Intelligence Operations. He got to meet all of these young people when they were fighting and being threatened with death every day in their lives, and it formed this special bond among them. During that time, in over three tours in Vietnam, he met many, many of these men. And they later, in their life, went on to become members of the Secret Service, FBI people, CIA people, people that were in police departments all across the country. And these people have served over the years as our special intelligence group. These are the people who actually care. They went into law enforcement because they cared. They went into law enforcement because they thought they were supposed to be there protecting people. They thought that they were supposed to be protecting the Constitution. And most of them have become rather disappointed about the way the world really was when they found themselves enmeshed in that kind of law enforcement world. So they longed for something ideal again. These were all, of course, as you might guess, baby boomers. They were all people from our generation who were there together. And so that when I ended up recruiting Bill later, after I left Lee Bailey's office, we recruited Bill to come and help us on the Karen Silkwood case. Some funny stories I'll tell you about that. But anyway, that he ended up reaching out to these people across the country and giving them an opportunity to do the right thing. And that became part of the secret of our success at the Christic Institute. But the chief source of our success at the Christic Institute was Sarah Nelson. And so I'll give you a little brief reading here of how I met Sarah. 40 minutes late, Sarah Nelson came sweeping into the amphitheater at the Institute for Policy Studies, just a few short blocks from our National Jesuit Headquarters building where I had my office. She was 30 years old, slim and tall at 5'9", with soft brown hair cut short in a feathered cuff. She was wearing a floor-length blue jean skirt that had been converted from a pair of old faded blue jeans, the cut pants legs of which had been sewn together with a brightly colored red-flowered cotton fabric. She also wore a green turquoise rolled-neck sweater. With a dough-colored tan complexion and bright hazel blue eyes, she was simply stated the most gorgeous human being that I had ever seen. All the men who were in the meeting already knew her. They turned subtly to observe my reaction to seeing her for the first time. I tried to remain inscrutable. When she came whirling into the room, she was hugging an armful of congressional reports and political flyers tight to her chest. She launched straight into a fervent speech about how we have to file a federal civil rights lawsuit on behalf of Karen Silkwood's three infant children and her family as a follow-up to the planned congressional hearings. She was inspiring. She spoke about Karen Silkwood's being one of us, of how if we don't do anything about their having killed one of our own, then we could not expect anyone to come and help us when our turn came to be martyred. She actually used that term, martyr, she said. These people in the FBI aren't going to do anything, so we have to get a joint hearing in the Senate and House. Then we have to do a federal lawsuit. She spoke of this with the naive confidence of a person untutored in the complex ways of Washington, D.C. But I could tell that she was actually going to make this happen. We were going to mobilize people all across the country to demand justice in the Karen Silkwood case. She was absolutely fabulous. Then she turned and swept out of the room, leaving us all to discuss without her. She was, as I would learn later, 40 minutes late already to her next meeting. The moment after she disappeared, Steve Wodka, a strikingly handsome, muscled 30-year-old, big mustached national organizer for the Oil, Chemical, and Atomic Workers Union, Karen Silkwood's union, turned around to me and, folding his arms in the back of his seat, said, "That is Sarah Nelson." And I was in. So that's how I first ran into Sarah. And Sarah and I got working together with a whole group of young boomers. Again, Kitty Tucker, who was in my constitutional law class at Antioch that I was teaching at Antioch Law School, and Steve Wodka from the Oil, Chemical, and Atomic Workers, Howard Cohn, who was the Washington bureau chief for Rolling Stone magazine, who was writing lots of articles about the Silkwood case, Bob Alvarez, who was the head of the Environmental Policy Institute, who was our expert on nuclear power plants, et cetera. And it led to this extraordinary investigation that we did, which is outlined here in the case. And there's a portion of you that remember the Karen Silkwood case and the details about it, but they're here again to refresh your recollection of what it is that happened. And there were these extraordinary moments that occurred in the case. For example, when we had the last of the rebuttal witnesses for the Kerr-McGee nuclear power plant on the stand, he was the engineer who had built the Kerr-McGee nuclear facility. And we were challenging him because they built the Kerr-McGee nuclear facility right in the middle of what is called Tornado Alley. And, of course, the reason that they built it there is because it was the home district of Robert S. Kerr, of Kerr-McGee, who was the congressman for four terms in Oklahoma, then the governor of Oklahoma for three terms, and then the United States senator for four terms. He was the second most powerful person in the entire United States Senate, only to Lyndon Johnson. And he was the Kerr of the Kerr-McGee Nuclear Corporation. And that's why they built it right there in his home district, even though tornadoes roared through there every spring. You know, the local television people would get in their cars and drive down the superhighway and lean out the windows videoing tornadoes coming down the road. I mean, that's where this was. So we had him on the stand, and we were in Jerry Spence was examining him. I was at the table, and Bob Alvarez comes in from the back of the courtroom, comes in like in a Perry Mason show, right? And he leans over and he says, "Come on, you got to come out in the hall. I got to tell you something." So I said, "Your Honor, just excuse me, I have to go up." So we got out of the courtroom, and he says, "There's the facility at Three Mile Island in Pennsylvania that's melting down right now." And so I went back in, and I pulled Jerry Spence aside, and I whispered to him, told him what was happening. So he goes over to the guy, and he says, "Okay, now you say that this facility is completely safe here at the Kerr-McGee facility." He said, "Yes." He says, "As safe as any other plant around the country?" He said, "Oh, yes, anyone." He said, "Like, for example, how about the Three Mile Island facility in Pennsylvania?" "Oh, yes, we're as safe as the Three Mile Island." So he went on and on and on. It went on for like about, must have been 6 minutes, getting the guy to drill down on it being just as safe as the facility, right? And we come back in the next morning waiting for some big explosion, you know, because everybody in the country knew what was happening by this time, except for the Kerr-McGee lawyers. Because it turns out that they were getting destroyed so badly in the case that they would just rush out of the courtroom and go right back to their law offices and huddle up trying to figure out how to survive the next day. So they came back in the next day, and they still didn't know what was going on. And so Jerry comes over to me and says, "Is it possible? Is it possible they don't know?" I said, "It looks like they don't know." So he went back in drilling on the guy. He went back over to the guy like this, and everybody was laughing in the courtroom. The jury was all laughing. We were all laughing. The Kerr-McGee lawyers were looking around like this. And Jerry just walked over and said, "No more questions," he says to him like that. Right. So those kind of moments happened over and over again. And we talk about these things in the book. In that we got ready for the closing argument. We got ready for the closing argument, and we brought Karen Silkwood's three children into the courtroom. And so they were sitting in the front row, right in front of the jury. We were getting set to do the closing arguments, and Bill Paul, the chief counsel for the Kerr-McGee Nuclear Corporation, the president of the Oklahoma State Bar Association, jumps up and he says, Your Honor, I'd like to object. Let me approach the bench." So we go up to the bench, and he says, "Look, not here. Come into the chambers. You know, we've got the jury in the box. getting ready for the closing arguments. Let's go into chambers. So we go into chambers. And Bill Paul says, Your Honor, I see these three children sitting in the front row there, and I'm assuming that they're the Soakwood children. And I think this is improper. They're sitting right there in front. He said, and they're not actually the plaintiffs in this case. The plaintiffs are the estate of Karen Soakwood. Well, I guess they're the heirs to the estate. I guess I don't quite know how to refer to these kids. And Judge Frank Tice, sitting behind his little desk, leans over and pulls his glasses down and says, How about incipient millionaires? So these are the kind of stories that are in the book that bring you inside those cases, the ones that you were reading about in the headlines and every night on the news and everything like this. But this is what it was like on the inside to be part of these things. And we virtually never saw the news about half of the things that we were doing. We used to joke with each other, you never get to see the news when you're making the news. But there's a number of other stories of how it is that we got to meet these different people that became sources for us. For example, here's how I got to meet another one of our major people. It was through my service as the chairman of the board of directors of the Fund for Constitutional Government that I met Paul Hoven, a weapons specialist and a consultant for our project on military procurement. That's when we ran that thing that used to blow the whistle on the $500 hammers and the $300 coffee pots for the Pentagon and all that. We ran that operation out of Washington.
$1 trillion wars.
There's some wars. It says, Paul Hoven was a classic soldier of fortune type, a huge guy, ruggedly handsome and barrel-chested. He would swagger into our meetings, proudly wearing his large belt buckle with the crossed swords of the 1st Air Cavalry. He was a former helicopter jock in Vietnam, member of a class of men who were to be respected. And in Vietnam, they had become familiar with various weapons systems. Paul liked to make a big show of his not liking or respecting liberals. And I ended up getting along with him quite well. He assumed all of us to be liberals, but he slowly began to discover that I wasn't a liberal. Hoven and I ended up getting along with each other. After he found out that I spent a couple of years in the U.S. Special Forces. Hoven was fascinated by the fact that my chief investigator was a former Marine Corps CID man, and that virtually all of my other investigators were former military criminal investigators. I think Hoven fancied himself to be a potential intelligence agent, in addition to fancying himself as a snake eater, as we called special operations guys, because they'd all been trained to eat snakes in the jungle if necessary. Hoven called me 6 months after we had begun the Iran-Contra investigation in November of 1985. You got a minute to meet me at the Goop place? He asked. This was how Hoven identified the Vietnamese restaurant on the north side of Capitol Hill where we used to meet. Sure, I said, what's up? He says, I'll tell you when we get there. Okay, I said. So I looked at my watch, it was 11:45. What time do you want to meet? How about 12, he said. Sure, I said, realizing that whatever he had to tell me, he must have at least thought it was important. I'll see you there. When I arrived, Hoven had already seated himself in the usual fog bank of camel smoke. This is going to kill you, Hoven, I laughed, waving at my way through the cloud of smoke. Yeah, well, nobody gets out of life alive, pal. He rose and stuck out his big ham-handed right hand, seizing mine. I always said that you missed your calling, Haas. You should have been a professional wrestler, I said. He frowned. He preferred it when I called him a snake eater. But then he laughed. You can be an asshole sometimes, Sheehan. Well, that's one of the reasons that you love me, Haas. It takes one to be one, I said. He struggled momentarily with the implications of this surprising ending, turning it over a bit too slowly in his brain, trying to determine whether the switch implied some insult to him. And once he determined that it was a surprise, and he laughed again and pulled me toward the empty seat at the table. I ordered the usual for us, he said. Let's get down to it. Go ahead, I said. Shoot. Last night, I was over at one of them shirt and tie affairs at the Heritage Foundation, he said. I groaned. He smiled. Look, some of us guys got to keep an eye on what those other guys are doing. I said, what do you mean, other guys, white man? I quipped, referencing the old kid's joke about the Lone Ranger and Tonto. Again, Hoven blinked, but he did not wait this time to try to translate the joke. Instead, he pressed on, acting on faith that I was not harpooning him. as he liked to say, by which of course he meant lampooning. While I'm there, he said, there was this old guy. He must have been, maybe 60, maybe 65. Anyway, this guy is really socking him down. It was an open bar, and he was standing right next to the bar all night, putting them away one after another. He was all by himself, and every time I went back for another beer, he would look at me and kind of mumble something, like he was trying to talk to me, but I wasn't sure. So the first few times, I ignore the guy. You know, you never know about these weird old people in Washington. Yeah, I said, I shrugged, urging him on. Well, like the third or fourth time this guy does this, I kind of catch his eye, and he gestures to me to come on over to talk to him. And he says to me, he says, hey, pal, you been to the NOM? Surprised, I said, yeah, I Corps, two tours. So then this guy lights up and throws his arm around me and drags me over to one of the bars and says, give my old Vietnam buddy here another beer, and give me one more, too. Anyway, this guy takes me out onto the back porch, and he starts crying on my shoulder about how some guy that he was in business with shipping humanitarian goods down to Nicaragua to all the refugees down there fleeing from the communists had screwed him over, had lost one of his planes, and how he was all pissed off and such. Finally, I realized that this guy seems to know what the hell he's talking about. All the names was right, all the places that he named was right, and he realized that I was actually listening, and he started to get more and more sober. Finally, this guy is laying this big story on me that, well, it was over my head. Then I remembered you. So I listened to this guy for a few more minutes, and then I says to him, I said, listen, I got this friend. He's kind of a guy. He went to Harvard, and you can figure out what he can figure out what he what you're talking about. Well, what does he need to do? I asked. What did he need to do? They lost his airplane, he said. They lost his airplane. Now Hovind was getting a little pissed off. Yeah, just like I told you, they lost his airplane. I couldn't figure out what it was he was fucking talking about. But I know that you would. I was just thinking, since you've been looking for somebody to be a plaintiff in that lawsuit that you've been trying to figure out against George Bush and his pals down in Nicaragua, well, I was figuring that maybe this is your guy, you know, loss of business property and all of that. I was genuinely impressed. Hovind had actually remembered everything that I had told him about how I was looking for a client that could bring a federal civil racketeering lawsuit. And I wanted to file it against a former CIA associate of George Bush. Now here it was, a potential client. Hovind set up a meet for me with this guy. The meet was to be at a friend's place out in Virginia. I didn't know who the friend was, but it didn't make any difference, so I said yes. 2 days after my lunch with Hovind, I drove out to Virginia and met him at a roadside restaurant. He was waiting for me across the street from the restaurant in a borrowed car with cigarette smoke pouring out of the driver's side of the window. I parked Father Davis's Blue Flame in the parking lot behind the restaurant and waited. I knew Hovind was there from the smoke, but I humored him and waited for him to make his presence known. After several minutes, he knocked on my window, looking around and over his shoulder. I rolled down the old hand-cranked window of the Blue Flame. Coast is clear, he said. Get out and follow me. We got out into his cigarette-smoke-filled car and headed into the hills. We arrived at the meet at dusk. There were no other cars in sight. We got out and entered a nondescript house. It was unlocked. As we entered the small living room, I could see in the growing darkness the outline of a man sitting in a large, overstuffed chair. A bottle of beer sat on the table to his right. I sat at the end of the couch, facing the man. Even though it was growing steadily darker, neither Hovind nor the man made any move to turn on a light. So I sat waiting. Hovind left and went into the kitchen. I heard him open the refrigerator and take out a bottle of beer. The sound of him opening the beer filled the silence. Then he came back into the small living room and silently stood against the door jamb. I said nothing. The man in the dark said nothing. He reached to his right and picked up his beer. You don't drink, he asked, into the darkness between us. The Brits invented whiskey to keep the Irish from taking over the world, I said. He laughed. He laughed, despite his obvious preparedness to emphasize the solemnity of the moment. Then it was silent again. He would try to reestablish the mood. Then, Haas tells me that you're a pretty bright guy. He's confused because he thinks I'm a Jesuit. Again, the man laughed to himself. And you're not? No, not yet. I'm a candidate for the Jesuits right now. Right now, I'm just their lawyer. Worst yet, he said. I recognize the accent. Oklahoma, I said. Somewhere around Tulsa. Silence filled the room. A pretty bright boy, he said, even if you're not a Jesuit. Yet, I added. Yet, he replied. Finally, after a long moment, he spoke again. Haas tells me, Haas, tell you what is going on? Something about you losing an airplane, I said again. Silence filled the room. After a long moment, he decided to risk it. I decided to risk it. You want to tell me about it? He said, why should I? I said, why shouldn't you? He laughed again. Hovind laughed too, somewhere behind me. I don't even know who you are yet, the man answered. You know more about me than I know about you, I said. Well, just what do you know about me, he said. Well, I know you come from Oklahoma. You probably served in the Air Force, I guess, since I knew that you owned planes. And I also guessed that you must be OSI, from the Office of Special Investigations, because I knew that Hovind had met him at the Heritage Foundation, which was involved in the higher end of right-wing activities, but I didn't mention that part. Silence, then. Gee, even Haas didn't get that part, he said. So I guess he didn't tell you that. You just did, I said. A wise man never gives away his tradecraft, he offered. I never said I was wise, just smart. Well, let's say well-educated, I said. By the Jesuits, he asked? No, by Henry Kissinger, Edward Reischauer, James Schlesinger, and John Kenneth Galbraith, I said. Well, 3 out of 4 ain't bad, he said. Now I laughed, and he laughed too. Hovind joined in from behind, and the ice was broken. I suspected, however, that Hovind didn't know exactly what we were talking about or why it was so funny. The man in the shadows then pulled himself forward onto the front edge of the cushion of the large overstuffed armchair that had held him in its folds until that moment. Haas told you that I'd lost a plane, he said, and that you had been fucked over by the guy that had talked you into letting him use your plane to ship weapons down to the Contras, I ventured. The latter, based upon what little Hovind had told me. The man sniffed, his head snapped back into the shadows. What makes you say that? Well, I know that you weren't flying humanitarian goods to any refugees fleeing from the communists in Nicaragua, because there aren't any refugees fleeing from the communists in Nicaragua, except for the Contras, and they're not exactly interested in humanitarian goods. They're interested in guns and ammunition and explosives. And what else? He asked. Here it comes, I thought. So I said, and cocaine, I said, surprised at how simply it had flowed out of me. Bingo, he said. These men lost one of my planes after I had agreed to let them use it. I was actually letting them use 20 of them. I was a little shocked and showed it. Did he mean 20 planes? Yeah, he said, noting my surprise, 20 of those little mini C-130 drop tails, like the big C-130, only smaller. Smaller payloads, easier to move around, civilian jobs, not military. Oh, I said, not bothering to disguise my ignorance. I had already stretched what I knew, and that I had only guessed to the limit, and it had worked so far, so I wanted to proceed from that point on. So this is how I got to meet this guy. This guy is Gene Wheaton. And it turns out that he was the affluent Farsi speaker, trained down at the Monterey Language Academy. He was the chief of security for the U.S. military mission in Tehran. Personal friends with the Shah of Iran and his son and others. And in fact, had been recruited by a man whose name he wouldn't give to me to actually provide his airplanes for flying alleged humanitarian goods down to the Contras. And his plane had been filled with cocaine on the way back up, and it crashed. And when he tried to make a claim for the insurance, they told him not to do that, just to leave it alone. Because when he challenged them, he was talking to Rob Owen, who was the right-hand man, as it turned out, to Oliver North. And Rob Owen told him, don't try to find it because it had cocaine in it. And so he got really upset about this. And he offered to introduce me to a guy that was the guy who actually is the guy who retained him and got his airplanes to bring the stuff down. And that's how I got to meet Carl Jenkins. And it turns out that Carl Jenkins was the CIA liaison officer for Theodore Shackley, who was the chief of station of the CIA in Saigon, in South Vietnam, mm-hmm. and that Carl Jenkins had been the liaison between Theodore Shockley and Vang Pao, who was one of the three opium warlords in Laos. And he began to tell me about how Theodore Shockley had set up an operation where he had Richard Secord of the United States Air Force conduct a major operation to drop incendiary devices on the two major competitors of Vang Pao in the opium trafficking in Laos, and so eliminated the two major competitors of Vang Pao, and therefore increased, like doubled, the amount of opium that could be being shipped by Vang Pao in exchange for getting a percentage of it given to Theodore Shockley, which they then used to finance the Phoenix program, which was the assassination program that Shockley was running in Southeast Asia to assassinate the people there. Now, I've done some of the obligatory reading out of here, but let me, since I know exactly what I said, let me tell you another interesting story. Some of the folks the night I talked about this, that we had a smaller gathering. That this is the when we filed the Iran-Contra case on May 28th of 1986. We filed it down in the Southern District of Florida in Miami, because we had discovered that, through Carl Jenkins and others, we discovered that the administration and the Enterprise were flying military equipment out of Fort Lauderdale-Hollywood Airport down in Florida and flying it down to Ilopango in El Salvador, and then unloading the weapons and flying them into John Hull's ranch down in Costa Rica. We knew all of this. So we filed the complaint. We put it together. And just before I filed it, I brought it over to the national Security Archives, the National Security Archives in Washington D.C. And Scott Armstrong is the guy that heads that up, and Tom Blanton runs it now, who's his assistant. But I brought it over to Scott Armstrong, and I showed him the complaint. And I said, look, I wanted you to take a look at this, because if there's any additional information you have to be able to support some of the details of the complaint here at the National Security Archives, I want that available so I can put it in, feather it into the complaint. And he said, and he looked at it and he said, gee, this isn't true, he said. None of this stuff is true, he said. Look, you got Theodore Shockley involved in this. Theodore Shockley, is not involved with the Contras in South America. Theodore Shockley was in Southeast Asia, he said. He was the Saigon station chief. He's not involved in this. And you got Richard Secord involved in this. Secord's not involved in anything in South America. If that was true, I'd know about it, he said. So, now Scott Armstrong was the fellow who was a staff assistant to the House Judiciary Committee during the investigation of the Watergate burglary. He was on Peter Rodino's staff, the chairman of the House Judiciary Committee. In fact, Scott Armstrong is the guy who got Alexander Butterfield to tell him about the taping system in the Oval Office. And so Scott Armstrong had become the great darling of Peter Rodino, of the chairman, because they got the goods. They got the actual tapes of the Watergate, the tapes. And so Scott Armstrong had risen to sort of stardom, mini stardom, in Washington, D.C. And so when he said, I would know about this if it were true, and I said, well, look, you obviously don't know about it, and it is true. So I'll tell you what, I'll give you a few days. You check with some of your sources and confirm that this is true, and you give me a call. So a few days later, he calls me back and he says, Danny, come on over. You got to come over. So I come over to the National Security Archives. It was just down the street from the Jesuit headquarters right up to Pont Circle. So I go over there and he said, I'll be damned. He said, this is true. He said, I checked with Cy Hirsch and a few other people. They didn't believe it at first, but as they checked it all out, it turns out it's true. He said, this is amazing. He said, look, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over to Peter Rodino, and I'm going to explain all this stuff to him. I'm going to show him the complaint, tell him that I've confirmed it through Cy and the other people. And then what he'll do is he'll put together a special select committee. He'll put together a special select committee. And he said, then I'll be made the chief of staff. I'll be made the chief of staff. Then we can impeach these bastards. So I said, fine. That sounds good to me. So he says, I'll give you a call in another couple of days. A couple of days goes by and I don't hear from him. I'm waiting. A couple days go by again, and I still don't hear from him. So I call over to the National Security Archives. I get a hold of Tom Bland. I say, Tommy, what the heck's going on? I said, Scott was going to give me a call. He says, oh, Dan, you got to come on over and talk to me. So I come over, and I sit down with Tom Bland, and I said, where's Scott? And he said, well, he's embarrassed. He said, I said, really, for what? He said, well, he took the complaint, and he went over, and he sat down with Peter Regino, the chairman of the Judiciary Committee, that has responsibility for investigating matters to be impeachable offenses. And he said, and he looked at the complaint, and he read the whole thing through, and he looked up, and he said to Scott, he said, my God, he said, this is horrible. He said, if what's being said here is true, but what I've been telling my constituents that if they didn't like the way the American foreign policy was being run, they ought to write a letter to their congressman. And he said, and if you write a letter to your congressman and they don't do anything, you ought to vote for somebody else and have a different congressman. He said, but if what is being said here in this complaint is true, why then we haven't even been in charge. I'm not going to allow the Congress of the United States to investigate anything like that. Is what he said. You know? And then Tom says to me, you know, and Scott feels like shit. I said, well, Scott is like shit. I said, you know, if he's not going to do anything more than that about this. You know, because the inside game wasn't working. You know, it took it right to the heart of it. And they wouldn't do anything about it. Okay? So I end up going down. We file the complaint. We file it on the 28th of May of 1986, and that's a Friday afternoon, about 4:30. And I come back up. Bill Taylor filed it for us at 4:30, so we can get it in on Friday afternoon. We get it in there. And Monday morning, 10 o'clock, back at our little cobbler shop office at the Christic Institute at the bottom of Capitol Hill, telephone call comes in. Patty Austin, my secretary, comes in and says, Danny, it's the judge from Florida. So I pick up the phone, and the guy says, Mr. Sheehan, this is James Lawrence King. I'm the chief judge of the United States District Court for the Southern District of Florida in Miami. I have your complaint in front of me right now. And I want to let you know, he says, I've decided to take this case myself, given the complexities of it, and I want to have you here in front of me by 2 o'clock this afternoon in my courtroom, or I'm going to enter a summary judgment against this complaint right now. And then he hangs up like that. So I go, whoo, wow, haven't had that one before. So I rush over, I get a suit out of the closet, and I jump in the suit, and I rush down to the airport and jump on a plane and fly down to Miami, take a cab over to the courthouse, and come into the courthouse. I come hook sliding into the courtroom about 1:45, and here's Judge James Lawrence King sitting up on the bench in robes, looking at his watch, you know, to see if I'm there on time. Then he looks up and he says, "Well, Mr. Sheehan, I'm glad to see that you made it here." He said, "But I'd like to introduce you to all the defense attorneys for the people you sued, and here's 24 lawyers sitting there Monday after the Friday 4:30 filing. They're all 24 lawyers are sitting there." And he said, here, I'd like to introduce you to the lawyer who's going to be representing Mr. Adolfo Calero, the man that you've alleged in your complaint was the head of the FDN Contras. And this is Mr. Anthony Lapham." And I said to myself, Anthony Lapham, why do I recognize that name? And I said, oh, yeah, he was chief counsel for the Central Intelligence Agency under George Bush, when George H.W. Bush was the director of the CIA from 1975 to 1977. He was the chief counsel for the CIA, and there he is. And the judge says, and this other lawyer here is going to be representing Ronald Joseph Martin Jr., the owner of the Tamiami gun shop, whom you allege in your complaint was providing the false end-user certificates for all of the weapons that were being shipped out of the Fort Lauderdale Hollywood Airport down to Ilopango. He said, and this is Mr. Richards. He said, Mr. Richard Williams. He said, you may recognize his name because he used to be the head of the criminal division in the United States Justice Department until last Friday at 5 o'clock. He has decided that he's going to retire now and go into private practice, and he's going to be representing, and I said, professional criminals, Your Honor, I think is the term. And he said, that's enough, Mr. Sheehan. That's one of the reasons I had you come down here. He says, I'm not going to have any of that stuff in this case. He said, I've called you down here to let you know that I'm, in fact, sealing this case right now. This case is under seal. And if you so much as mention the existence of this case to a soul. I'm going to personally have you put in federal prison for 6 months for direct criminal contempt of this court. And I said, well, Your Honor, I said, that's kind of interesting. And exactly on what authority do you think you have to do that? And he said, well, you may not be familiar with the federal rules of civil procedure down here in the Southern District. And I said, well, I assume they're the same federal rules as everywhere else. Yeah. I said, which happened to be written by my professor, Shapiro, of civil procedure that we helped write in my class. I said, at Harvard. And he looks down at me and he says, okay, he said, okay, I just wanted to make sure that you were told in person that this is the way this is going to be. And I said, look, I just want to let you know that I don't have the slightest intention of obeying that. And he said, well, you've been warned and on the record. And so I said, so are we done now? Okay, that's it, what you asked me to come down here for? He said, that's it. So I said, thanks, and I walked out. So I walk out, and I go back up, I fly back up home. And the next morning, now Tuesday, this is about the 1st of June of 1986, I pick up the telephone and I call Russ Hemingway. Russ Hemingway is a good pal of mine. He was the chairman of the Fund for Constitutional Government that I read about before I was, right? And he was an old, close friend of John Kennedy's in the Navy. They were in the Navy together. A very sophisticated, aristocratic guy, very bright, you know, and the head of a thing called the Fund for an Effective Congress. They raise money, he likes to say, we raise money for all the liberal congressmen, whether they're Republicans or Democrats. And so that he was very well positioned, so I called him and I told him what had happened. He said, look, what I'm going to do is I'm going to have you go over and meet with Peter Rodino. And I said, no. He said, no, let's make it Tip O'Neill. We'll go to Tip O'Neill, you know, the whole Speaker of the House. We'll have you go and meet with him. So I go over and I sit down with Tip O'Neill and I explain the whole thing to him. And he said, look, there's nothing we can do about this right now. We've got to see whether or not the Democrats, whether we're going to take over the Senate in the fall. If we can take over the Senate in the fall where the trial would go on, then we can do something about this. So the bottom line is that's how we set up the whole process of setting up a special select committee that would investigate all of these charges. Okay, and it ended up having John Kerry put in charge of that. And John Kerry is the guy who shut down the entire investigation. Wow. That John Kerry shut down the investigation at the request of the Democratic Party leadership because the Republicans approached them and said, look, if you will agree to stop this investigation, the federal judge can dismiss the case down in Florida. And that what we will do then is if you will shut down this investigation, the Republican Party will agree to withdraw their demand for $100 million of military funding for the Contras, and we'll join with the Democrats in supporting covert funding through the CIA to Chamorro, who is the person opposing the Sandinista government in the Democratic elections coming up. So that's what he did. He closed down the investigation, pretended he wasn't able to figure anything out. They shut the whole thing down. And the judge then entered an order of summary judgment against us and said that if we attempted to appeal the case, that he was going to enter a Rule 11 order of sanctions against us for undertaking a case without adequate support. Even though we had tail numbers, serial numbers on the weapons, the shipping schedules, we had the code words that you used to land at John Hull's ranch. We had all of that. But he entered an order of summary judgment against us. The Democrats joined together with the Republicans and shut down the investigation. And I remember when they shut down the investigation, the special prosecutor had then indicted six of the people whom we had named as major participants in the off-the-shelf enterprise, and George H.W. Bush pardoned all of them. Mm. He pardoned all of them. And George H.W. Bush, before he left, entered an order to the Internal Revenue Service to revoke the 501c3 tax-exempt charter of the Christic Institute for engaging in political activity against the Bush administration. So all of these stories are in here, but what they do is they open onto the one final story that I want to tell you in here that you'll find in the book. And that is this, because it leads on to the major issue I want to discuss with you. And that is that when I was introduced to a man who wanted to talk to me after we filed the Iran-Contra case. I was introduced to him by Dick Billings, a guy that you'll learn about later in the book. But Dick Billings said, look, there's a man that wants to talk to you if you will come and meet with him. So I went over to meet with him at the Dubliner Cafe in Washington, D.C., right at the foot of the Capitol Hill. Dick brings me into the Dubliner Cafe, and here's this guy, maybe 70, 72 years old, sitting at the table. And Dick walks me over, and he said, Dan Sheehan, Joe Smith. And he sticks his hand out, and I said, yeah, Joe Smith, hello. And he said, no, I get that a lot. He said, my name is Joseph Burkholder Smith, and I was the deputy CIA station chief in Mexico City back in 1973. And he proceeds to tell me the story, how Theodore Shackley, the guy in our complaint that we had named as one of the key figures, that he had become the head of Western Hemisphere operations for the CIA. And he had removed all of the CIA station chiefs from all of the stations in the Western Hemisphere, arguing that Phil Agee was in the process of writing a book about the CIA inside the company, and that he may know the names of the station chiefs, and he didn't want them compromised. So he used that as his leverage for dismissing all of the station chiefs and putting in all of his own guys. And one of the guys that he put into power, according to Joseph Smith, was a guy by the name of Tom Polgar. Tom Polgar was made the chief of station in Mexico City. And Tom Polgar comes into my office, says Joseph Smith, the next morning, and he says, Joe, I'm not sure we're going to leave you on here as my deputy. There's going to be a guy coming in tomorrow morning about 10 o'clock. You'll recognize who he is. He's going to ask you a few questions. And he may even ask you to go and meet with some people who may have a few questions. And depending on how you answer those questions, that'll determine whether or not you're going to be left on here as the deputy station chief. So the next morning, he said, at 10 o'clock in the morning, into his office walks Nasser Haro. Nasser Haro is the head of the DFS in Mexico. That's like the combined CIA and FBI in Mexico. And he comes into the office and he says, Joe, he said, Polgar told you that I was going to probably be coming to see you. There's some people I'd like to have you come and meet. They've got some questions for you to see whether you're going to be left on here as the deputy station chief. So he said, we leave the office, we go downstairs, we get into one of these little smoke-windowed little trucks and drive away. And we go to the Mexico City airport. They go completely around security and get into a private Learjet, and they fly away. And they fly and fly and fly and fly, and they land in Buenos Aires. And they land in Buenos Aires, they come down, they go around all the security, get into a helicopter, and fly away together. And they fly all the way up into the northwestern corner of Argentina and land in this little town on this little soccer field with dust flying all around. And they get out of the helicopter, and he says, I'm following Nasser Haro across this soccer field, and we go up this little embankment. I look over the embankment, I look down, I thought I was in Bavaria, he said. I look down in there. There's this little, like, Bavarian town there in Argentina. And so we walk up across the thing, we go down into the little town, and Nasser Haro leads me into this little Bavarian inn. And here are these six guys sitting there behind this great big oaken table in front of a big stone fireplace. And on the mantle over the fireplace is a big swastika flag. Okay, this is 1973, right? And the guy gestures for me to sit down, so I sit down at the table, and he says, Joe, you know, we got some questions for you here. He says, about whether you could be left on as the deputy station chief in Mexico City. He said, we just spent a lot of time and energy creating a new major cocaine cartel down in Medellin, Colombia. And that cocaine is going to be distributed around and into the United States, and a portion of those profits are going to be used to conduct the war without boundaries. Our war against your enemies and ours. And we just want to make sure that if you're going to be left on as the deputy station chief, that you aren't going to do anything to interfere with that. And he turns to me, he said, and Dan, he said, I swear to God, he said, I don't know anything that I had done in my life that would have led them to believe that I would have gone along with that. Yeah. And I said, well, how about being the deputy CIA station chief in Mexico City for a start? I said, and he looked at me and he went, and he turns to Dick Billings and he said, I thought he was going to cooperate with us on this. And Dick said, hey, I just met him. So he gets up from the table. Joseph Burkholder Smith gets up from the table and walks around. And he leans over to me and he comes over to me like this. And he leans out and he sticks his hand out like this. And he said, I just wanted to make sure that you knew who you were dealing with in this case. And that was the story right there. Because that's what leads to the second book. That's what leads to the second book. Who are these people? Why do they have connections like this? Who are the power that make determinations as to who our deputy station chief is going to be? Why are they smuggling cocaine like this into the United States? What is it that's going on here? And so those are the fundamental questions. And so that even though in the Iran-Contra case, even though we shut down the enterprise, we shut down the smuggling of the weapons down to the Contras, the Democrats and Republicans together joined together to bob and weave and decide that they were going to covertly fund the Chamorro to beat the Sandinista government in the election that time. So they got around us in that case. But in the process, we learned what is going on. And we've delved into that. We have lots of information about that, which we're going to be putting in the second book. So we wanted to just come and sort of whet your appetite a bit, but we're in the process of writing it now. And, but what I want you to buy the book and to read the book and to get prepared so that you understand the 1 mile wide and the 10 foot deep. So you see the spread of what these cases were, how we kind of unfolded this information kind of one step at a time. Why is it that the Karen Silkwood plant, why is it that it turns out that what Karen has stumbled across was the fact that they were smuggling 98% pure bomb-grade plutonium out of that facility and smuggling it to the state of Israel for their nuclear weapon, and at the same time bringing it to Iran for their nuclear weapon under the Shah. Why is that? Why would something like that be going on? And why is it that in the Iran-Contra case you find that you're dealing with World War II Nazis meeting with our Central Intelligence Agency, mounting a campaign of assassination called Operation Condor all through Latin America, assassinating and killing people. Very similar to the Phoenix program in Southeast Asia that killed at least 20,000 non-combatant civilians, assassinated them and killed them. So these are the things that are the questions that got raised by this book. But at the same time, we had partial victories at each stage of the operation. And it generated the reputation that the Christic Institute had before they revoked our 501c3. But we have now been given a new 501c3 as the Romero Institute, which is now here in Santa Cruz, that we have been set up. We're over in the Galleria, right up over the Democratic Party headquarters. And so we're there now. We're working on the second book. We got the first one done. We're teaching a course. It's going to start tomorrow night at UCSC. It's called The Alternative Theories of the Assassination of President John Kennedy. And it's going to lay out all 10 of the major theories of the assassination, including in the 10th week, the one that is the subject matter of a book that we're working on right now, which is the second book. Okay, so that's the initial presentation, we're available. I'm going to be available to sign books. If you want to buy the book, we can sign it for you here, and I can answer any questions that you've got for probably 3 minutes. Yeah, right. 3 minutes. Okay.
I just wondered.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah. Woody Allen.
Paul. Just give a fair Peter Schottky as the real evil villain of your whole story.
Yeah, Theodore Shackley is in effect the Dr. Moriarty of our sort of Sherlock Holmes activity as the Christic Institute. Theodore Shackley was born in Germany before World War II, as a German citizen, came to the United States as a boy, became a naturalized American citizen, and at the beginning of World War II, enlisted in the United States Army, became a German and Polish-American translator for the 101st Counterintelligence Corps. He, in fact, became the chief translator for Reinhard Gehlen. Reinhard Gehlen was the Waffen-SS commander of the anti-Soviet and anti-Eastern Bloc intelligence for the entire Third Reich. And he turned himself in at the end of World War II, offering to bring in his entire organization, his anti-communist organization, if the United States would agree to take all of them off the Nuremberg war criminal lists. And then he was made the head of West German intelligence, Reinhard Gehlen. And his chief deputy became Theodor Schacklin, the American guy who was in the entering class of the Central Intelligence Agency in 1948, after the passage of the National Security Act of 1947. Theodor Schacklin was the deputy to Reinhard Gehlen until 1961. In 1961, he was brought over from Berlin and brought in to become the chief of station of Miami. And he ran the largest CIA station in the world outside of Langley, operating against Cuba, the entire covert operations going on against Cuba. And he was, in fact, the CIA station chief in Miami on November 22nd of 1963. That becomes very relevant. And that he went on to become the CIA station chief in Laos after a short stint of being the acting CIA chief in Rome, where he actually helped finance the Gladios, the covert stay-behinds of the Nazis from World War II that are throughout Europe. And then went into Laos and set up this operation I told you about the cocaine, getting a percentage of the opium trafficking in Southeast Asia to fund the Phoenix program. He became the director of Western Hemisphere Operations and was handpicked. It was handpicked by George H.W. Bush to be the chief of covert operations of the Central Intelligence Agency worldwide for George Bush. That's who the guy is. So he's been at every site. You know, if you happen to think from reading the book that I happened to be at virtually every site during the 60s, this guy was on the other side of almost every one of those operations. And you'll read about him in the book. That's Theodor Schacklin. Mm. Yeah.
So you're talking a historical perspective of what's been going on. Do you connect it to what's going on today?
Oh yes. The fact of the matter is, yeah. The question was, is that this is kind of an historical story about how what was going on back during those times. Is it in any way connected to what's going on now? It certainly is. Because to make it clear, when we left Washington D.C. in 1992, right after Bush Senior had been defeated for his second term, we came out to California to Santa Barbara to teach, and I was asked to do the Cesar Chavez memorial lecture, and I did an analysis of the special prosecutor's investigation. Special Prosecutor Lawrence Walsh, and compared it to what our investigation was. And in the closing final report of the Special Prosecutor Lawrence Walsh, he said that because of the lack of political will on the part of not only the Republican Party, but the Democratic Party alike, to actually get to the bottom of what was really going on in the Iran-Contra scandal, he said, it's important to remember that the power that Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North had derived from the fact that he was the deputy director of the National Security Council in charge of anti-terrorism. That the whole energy that was involved in that off-the-shelf enterprise involved a major political assassination operation going on around the world to assassinate people that they thought were potential terrorists. And so that what the special prosecutor said, that if the Republican and Democratic Party failed to have the will necessary to remove these men and to get rid of them, that we were going to be haunted by these people and that they were going to come back to haunt the country under the rubric of anti-terrorism, and that this whole rolling into place of a national security state like we have now, where all of our emails are being monitored, all of our telephone conversations are being recorded and kept, that everywhere we go on our telephones, they're monitoring where we are. They're keeping a record of where we are because they keep a record of the towers to keep hooking into where you are. And so they have a record of where you were at any given time, and all the time. And they keep files on all of that. They know who you're writing to. They know who you're talking to. And the problem is that the American people are now becoming acclimated to this. That the people are actually saying, well, you know, if it's necessary to protect us against Osama bin Laden, and all these people, it's okay. I don't mind them taking my constitutional rights. I wasn't using them anyway. And so that's the crisis that we're in right now. That we are in fact now experiencing every day. the consequences of the warning that was given to us by the special prosecutor. And the Christic Institute would like to say, we told you so. You know, we told people at the time that they had to stop these people. We gave them the opportunity. They had the golden opportunity there at the end of the Cold War. Okay, we filed this in 1986. The case went all the way through to 1992. The Soviet Union dissolved on December 31st of 1991. It gave us the exact opportunity that we needed to dissolve the Central Intelligence Agency. It had been designed ostensibly by the National Security Act of 1947 to confront the threat of worldwide domination by the Soviet Union. And now that they actually dissolved themselves voluntarily, there was no more reason to continue this. So we had the great opportunity of demonstrating that these people were completely out of control. Except the problem is, the reason they didn't want to do anything about it is because they weren't out of control. They were, in fact, under control. The question is, under whose control were they? They're clearly not under the control of the American people. They're clearly not under the control of the intelligence committees or the people in Congress. They're not even under the control of a given president who happens to not agree with what they're doing. Okay? And so that has posed the fundamental question that we have to address now. And because of what's happening now, with the enactment of the National Security, National Defense Authorization Act, for example, that was signed at 11:55 at night on New Year's Eve of 2011 by Obama, you know, which actually it's important for people to know, as we stand here right now, every single one of us is subject to immediate arrest by military officials here in the United States without any probable cause to believe that we've committed any crime whatsoever, to be taken into custody with no notice to any of our relatives or friends or anyone else, and to not be allowed a lawyer, not only not be provided a lawyer, but not even be allowed to have a lawyer if you want to hire one. And you can be put in front of a military tribunal and tried without knowing what the particular charges are against you and without having the witnesses presented against you because it would compromise national security to reveal who they were. But the information can be given to the panel of the military judges who are military officers. The same group that arrested you are the ones sitting in judgment on you. And that you can be convicted not by a unanimous panel, but by just a majority of the panel. And you can be sentenced up to life in prison without any right to appeal to any civilian court. You can, in fact, be executed without the right to appeal to any other court. And tortured first, you know, to determine what it is you might know.
And it's
not constitutional. You need to remember that the same thing happened in Germany from 1924 to 1934 to 1938. All those times they rolled into place one thing after another, one regulation statute after another, where it became legal. And because they had no constitution like we do, they didn't have the ability to say, well, it may be, the statute may authorize it, but that's not constitutional. We do have that right. We have our constitution. And the fact of the matter is that, you know, it's time for us to wake up and realize that we're in a bad dream here. And the test is are we going to tolerate this? Because I think what we ought to do, and I've talked about it before, I think what we ought to do is we have to take a lesson from when we were back during the Karen Silkwood case and the Three Mile Island case, when we got those orders stopping the construction of any new nuclear power plants in the United States, the administrations all freaked out. And what they wanted to do is they wanted to go to all 103 presently operating nuclear facilities and take all the nuclear waste materials off the site and ship it across country and put it into a single facility underneath what's it, Mountain? And outside of it in Nevada. They wanted to put it under the ground in there, right? Turns out to be over the major aquifer in southwestern United States. So that's what they wanted to do. But what we all did, we mobilized and we got our city councils and our county boards of supervisors to enact nuclear free zones. You remember? We got rules passed prohibiting the transport of any of those dangerous nuclear waste materials through our jurisdictions. And our city councils supported it, and our county boards of supervisors, state legislatures. That's what we need to do now.
Yes.
We need to get the city of Santa Cruz declared to be a constitutional rights protection zone.
Yes.
That in fact they will not obey They will not obey the National Defense Authorization Act. They will not allow any federal officials to come in to arrest any citizens of Santa Cruz without probable cause to believe that we've committed a crime. They need to bring the information to a magistrate. We need to have the right to counsel. We need to have the right to habeas corpus. We need to have the right to confront our accusers. That we will not tolerate this, because they are actually sitting and drafting memos right now. Guys like David Addington and John Yoo and all these guys that drafted up those torture memos, they're saying that our acquiescence, with full knowledge that this is going on right now, our acquiescence to that can be taken as direct evidence of the fact that we agree to it.
Yes.
And because if you don't protest, they're saying that you're agreeing to it. And so that's exactly there. John Yoo has written a book about this, the National Security Constitution, talking about the fact that this type of acquiescence on our part, on the part of the Congress, on the part of law enforcement officials, to this type of conduct is taken as direct evidence that we support it. Okay? So what I'm saying is that it's not up to us, the Christic Institute or the Romero Institute, to have to do this by ourselves. It's up to our citizens. It's up to you. It's up to draft up a petition to go to the city council, to have the city council vote and declare Santa Cruz to be a constitutional rights protection zone. In fact, there's a website that we've got up. Where's Rob? Is he here? There's a website.
Constitutional rights protection zones on Facebook.
On Facebook. So you can sign up there and participate in this, become part of a petition, set up meetings with the city council, set up meetings with the county board of supervisors, and insist that they pass resolutions on this. The fact of the matter is the state legislature has already passed a resolution. Both the House and the Senate have passed a resolution saying they disagree with it. But it's just a resolution. What you've got to do is you've got to get this enacted in every single city and every single county in the state. And once California has done this, we move out into the other states across the country. The people are not going to tolerate this if they have some meaningful leadership on this.
I'm just curious. I don't know what the different legal ramifications are, but for example, when we had, California said marijuana was okay, but the feds came in and did horrible things.
Yeah.
How would that work in terms of, if we say, okay, this is a protection zone, how does that interplay with the feds?
The fact of the matter is, if our city council says that no federal officials can come in here and arrest anybody without probable cause under the authority of the National Defense Authorization Act, the question is, will the sheriff's department and the city police protect us against criminal conduct on their part? Coming in to try to seize somebody and kidnap somebody is basically like renditions. They used to kidnap people right off the streets without any pretense of having probable cause. And then whisk them away to Egypt somewhere to be tortured. This stuff has been going on by the Bush administration, but the fact that it's going on under the Obama administration causes all kinds of people who are registered Democrats to go, well, it can't be that bad if Obama is doing it, or else Obama won't do it to anybody except those that really deserve it. That's that old Niemöller quote that we all know about. And what I'm saying I'll give an example. When in fact the federal officials came in and arrested the two women that were growing medical marijuana with proper licenses and everything here in Santa Cruz,
yeah,
what happened is the following month, we set up a process by which the medical marijuana the following month was distributed in the city council, in the city council chambers. It was distributed to the people in the city council chambers with deputy sheriffs standing guard all around the city's council to keep any federal officials from coming in to arrest anybody. That's the kind of action that means something. Okay? That's the kind of constitutional rights protection zone that we have to have, to mobilize armed force to protect us against the unjust assertion of armed force at the behest of some right-wing set of Zanos who are basically trying to dominate and control the federal government right now. It's as simple as that. And it's we've all been there. That's what the 60s were all about. What happens if they draft you and you don't go? And the people all say, wait a second, if they draft me, I have to go, don't I? You say, no, you don't have to go. You don't have to go, I don't have to go. We don't, any of us have to go. And when everybody stops going, then they've stopped the war.
Yeah.
Okay? That's what has to happen now. We need to rise up and we need to stand up against these people. We have to stand up against the John Yoos, the David Addingtons, the Dick Cheney's. You know, I mean, put these people in a row and look at them, you know, and see what we're dealing with here. You know, we don't have to tolerate this type of conduct. And the story in the book of the People's Advocate is the story of how just a few of us stood up, and then more and more of us stood up, and more and more of us stood up. We stood up against the private nuclear power industry. We stood up against the enterprise. We stood up against the administrations of Bush and Reagan, and we brought them to a stop. And that's what we have to do again. Okay, so that's the story of the People's Advocate that I want you to get a copy of, and I want you to read it. View it as a primer. View it as a textbook. View it as a training manual, you know, to figure out what we have to do in the present time, because it's the present time we have to worry about. That all of the history is just a prologue to training us to get ready for what we have to do now. Okay, Barbara. Yes.
I have a question. Is the apostle referring to apostles, number one? And the clarification. I got an email today that I understood that the state legislature has actually passed a law or a resolution that says that no official in California shall enforce any unconstitutional provision of NDAA or any other federal law. Is that not correct?
No, that's true. What they've done is they've passed the resolution saying that no state law enforcement officers will enforce the federal law. State law enforcement officers don't enforce the federal law. So it doesn't really mean anything. The question is whether the state law enforcement people are going to protect us against the federal enforcement of the law. That's the key that has to get changed here. Okay, so what it is, it's a great cosmetic appearance saying, oh, you know, look, you guys don't go enforcing this. Well, that's not helping us much. We need new language. We need a new statute. Okay, we need to do it from the grassroots up so that they'll know that we understand we haven't been fooled by that.
But it's a good start.
It's a good start. It shows kind of a general spirit of what we're talking about. And the second question is, no, Haas. Haas was the name that we used to refer to Paul Hovind. Then Hassenfuss is the different guy. And I'll tell you one.
Well, the lost plane. Was that Hassenfuss's plane?
It was the plane. It was not the lost plane. No. That Hassenfuss's plane was the C-123, the fat lady. That was that one. That was the one that was actually being flown by Richard Brennecke up out of Panama and landing at the Iron Mountain Ranch of, what's the name? I can't remember his name right now. But the bottom line is that we have to mobilize now.
Yes.
That all of this is good for reminiscing and kind of sentimental recollection of how great it was back in those halcyon days. But the fact of the matter is, all of that was training. As is pointed out by William Strauss and Neil Howe, there's a book that you ought to be able to find. Maybe it's here. There's a book called Generations, A History of America's Future. And what it talks about is the fact that in every generation, every 100-year cycle of our country, there is a generation that is an idealist generation. And that generation rises up when they become 18 to 21 years old. They rise up and they challenge the established order, confronting them for being hypocrites, for not fully effectuating the values and beliefs that we've been taught by them. That's what happened in the 60s. That's what our generation did. We are that idealist generation of this 100-year cycle. We are the idealist generation of the 21st century. And what happens is that there comes a point in time when the members of the idealist generation, after having mounted this 10-year assault against the established powers and have been pushed back temporarily, they come to the point where they get to be 65, 66 years old, and they start reminiscing. They start gathering together and talking sentimentally about the old times and how great it was, and weren't we all great, and weren't those the great halcyon days. And they begin to suspect that their best days were behind them. But, as Neil Howe and Strauss have pointed out, every single time, four times in the past, has turned out to be true that their best years were ahead of them. That occurred from 65 to 85 years old, because the crisis that is going to descend upon the country is going to descend upon the country because of the failure of the country to listen at that time, in those 10-year period, to try to solve the problems of the environment and global warming that is going to descend upon us, the problems of the rise of the national security state in our country. These things are going to descend upon us as a major crisis here in the 21st century. And that what happens every single time is that the idealist generation start gathering together sentimentally discussing all of these prior years, they end up discovering that they're preparing to mentor the new civic generation. These young kids that are now basically 30 years old down to about maybe 9 years old right now. The kids that are in the colleges and in the graduate schools right now. That's the reason that we're back here teaching at the university now, to reach out to the millennial generation kids. Because that's the alliance that always gets forged. The idealists and the civic generation. In our generation was the largest, best educated, most idealistic generation in the history of the human family. 82 million people in our generation. The civic generation, the sonic boom babies, are in fact the second largest, the second best educated. There's 72 million of these kids. And together, the 82 million and the 72 million make up a huge, massive, critical mass in our country. And they run from about 30 years old down to about 9 years old right now. That's the group. And the baby boom generation runs from being born starting on February 3rd of 1943, the actual morning after the 5th Army of Germany was crushed in front of the gates of Stalingrad. And that everybody realized that the war was effectively over. And it just took time to kind of mop up this whole thing. But everybody who started being born after that morning, February 3rd of 1943, was born into a rising sense of elan, a rising sense that everything was possible, that we can succeed if we all work hard enough at it. And we were all raised with that ethos. That's the baby boom generation. That's what makes an idealist generation. Okay? That's who we are.
Danny, I'm wondering if you would be willing to draft a petition around which a local movement, you know, could be built.
Why don't you stand up and say a word about that, Claire?
So we are ready. My husband stand up. We go. Rico Baker, Claire Joy. We already have drafted something that we have presented to Danny, and now that we have heard what this Facebook site is, we want to add that link. We are completely willing to do this. You know, we've got to do it now.
Yes.
Danny's telling us.
Yes.
It's now or never. So, and I guess our information will be on the Facebook page.
What's the site again?
What page? Well, they just gave it.
Constitutional Rights Protection Zone.
Yeah, that's it.
If you're on the email list, there's sort of a bonus to all this, too.
Yeah.
Danny's course that he taught at UCSC last year on the trajectory of justice, all the cases that are covered in the biography told to pre-law students and so on. You can get the private links to that on YouTube. They'll be sent to you if you're on this list, in addition to the links to the Facebook page.
Yes.
So if you're not on the list already, get on the list.
Yeah, everybody be sure to get signed up here.
Okay.
No, we're still doing it. We're getting it all together again.
I just want to issue a warning. You better start this book early in the morning and plan not to sleep for a couple of days. You can't put it down.
It is hard to put down.
You can't put it down. And just a quick question. Amongst the guys that were down there stirring up trouble in the 1963, Carl Jenkins is one that's still alive. Is he someone that will be called to reckon?
Well, that's an interesting question. The question as to what role, if any, he's going to play has to do. Shackley's dead. But the question is whether or not we can mobilize an authoritative enough tribunal that can grant immunity to people to testify about things that they know about, mm-hmm. much like the tribunal in South Africa that happened, that whole thing that they went through of bringing the military people forward to acknowledge the massacres they engaged in, the torture they engaged in, etc., to try to purge that from our body politic. These are questions that are going to be answered. What we have to do is mobilize through the writing of the second book, etc., to get these issues back up on the table. But that unless and until we can mobilize against these things that are right directly in our face right here, you know, we have to build up our muscles. We have to build up our collective communitarian muscles to rise up against this national security state, because the people that are the elected officials, all they basically do is follow. And the problem is they follow the people that pay for their elections right now, the major corporations and stuff. And that only when we rise up and threaten to remove them from office and to replace them with other people will they actually do anything. And the reality is we'll probably have to replace them, you know, because that always scares them when you say it. But, you know, as long as they think that all they have to do is get a little bit better, and they'll only get as better as they have to keep staying in there. You know, so that we have to mobilize this thing right now.
Well, the book is incredible. I know it will catalyze all of you the way it has catalyzed us. It makes it possible for us to know that we can do something. I think a lot of us have felt we're being aware of what's going on and the surveillance cameras that we see outside and NDAA that we hear about, and we think there's nothing we can do. Thanks to this book, it is clear that not only is there something that we can do, we each must do it, and we must do it now. And look at us. Look at all of us who are here tonight. This is the time for Santa Cruz to really come together to do what we have to do, to write the petition, to go to the city council. These are things you talked about, Sarah. Education, fundraising, and organizing. Those are the three things. And we all have a little bit that we can do. And, you know, it's about all of us. It's about this country. It's about our Constitution. And if not now, I don't know.
Really? Not us. Different, totally different. Yeah. Okay, look, so we want to have time for people to get the book and get it signed if you want. So I have to go up and set up a little table and sign the books for everybody. We can talk more about it some other time in an organizing meeting. Okay? So everybody be sure to sign up. Okay? This is just for us so we can get back to everybody. So we have everybody's communication. So we can... Pardon? Oh, we've already signed. The book, the books are up here. The books are up here for sale. Thank you.